Hello and welcome to a brand new Let's Play. I'm your host, Imperialis, and today we're going to be taking a look at something completely different. This is a game called Emperor of the Fading Suns. It's an older game. It was published in either 1996 or 1997, I can't remember. But it was published by a company called, well, developed and published by a company called Holistic Design. And they're also fairly well known, or somewhat well known, I guess, for producing what was probably one of the best Warhammer games ever made, and certainly the best until probably Dawn of War came out, called Warhammer 40K Final Liberation, which was absolutely fantastic game, and I might potentially do something with at some point down the road here. But yeah, this is Emperor of the Fading Suns. It's actually based on a role-playing game, also published by Holistic Design, and what they're better known for. The game is still, they're still printing books for it, and it's still in production. I never played it very much. I was more of a Dungeons & Dragons and Shadowrun fan, and still am, actually. But this was a really, really interesting take on what you could do with sort of a franchise-type game. It's not a role-playing game, it's actually a war game, and it's a bit of a rediscovery for me. I did play this back in high school, but when it first came out, I didn't have a computer that could run it, and then later on, when I had a computer that could run it, I was running Windows 98, and I had some compatibility issues, and it would crash on me all the time and everything like that, so I was never able to play it as much as I wanted to. And now that I actually have this running, and running reasonably well, I figured I'd take another crack at it. It's a bit of a rediscovery, like I said. There's a video that was put out by James, I believe his name is, from Extra Credits. He's one of the writers for that show, where he was reminiscing about it, and it got me in turn reminiscing about it, and figured I would try and rediscover it. Include a link to the description, or a link to the video in the description if you want to check that out. Now, one of the things with this is I was not able to get the music running at all. No music, no cutscenes. There's only one cutscene in it, but the music is fantastic. So what I've done instead is I actually found a YouTube playlist of the music, and I just have that playing in the background. So it won't be dynamic or anything like that, but at least you can hear the music, because it really is a brilliant soundtrack. But I'm also running this with a mod called Emperor of the Fading Suns Reality, and more specifically, Emperor of the Fading Suns Reality Emperor Wars. This is a mod, it's still being worked on. The last update for it came out back at the beginning of August of 2014, and it's really interesting what he's done. I mean, first of all, he rebalanced a lot of the units. He did some stuff to try and overcome some of the shortcomings of the AI. But he also went through all of the... Sorry, just adjusting my volume. All of the Fading Sun source books and set up the game so that the start of the game was much more in line with sort of the lore of the pencil and paper game. And so if you're at all familiar with Fading Suns, if you've played it before, you'll know that you typically start very, very weak. You've got some holdings on your home planet, but there's still... Sorry, adjust this volume down a bit more. Better. You typically start very, very weak. You've got a lot of rebels on your home planet. You only have any control over one planet. And the first sometimes up to 30 turns of the game can be very, very slow as you try to expand out and build up to the point that you can actually start playing the game properly. So everybody starts with more holdings, more power, things like that, and an actual functioning economy as well. That was one of the issues that existed in the base game, is you would start out and the first turn you're losing tons and tons of money. Introduced a whole bunch of new units and stuff as well, but anyhow, we'll see that when we get into it. So I'm just going to start a new game here. Now, it has been about a decade since I played this at all. And so I'm not going to be going out of my way to challenge myself with this. A lot of this is going to consist of me relearning how the game works. But for the purposes of this playthrough, the way it works is you pick one of five noble houses. And this part of the setting is very much inspired by Dune. Basically, the Coles Notes version of the setting is there was a Galactic Republic Golden Age, and then everything went to pot, and fractured into a whole bunch of different noble houses, reverted to feudalism, that sort of stuff. It's very much inspired by Dune, and I also want to say Battletech. It's sort of the inner sphere, the idea of the lost technology that doesn't exist anymore. And then it also has a lot of influence, particularly in the church, from Warhammer 40,000, where technology is seen as being dangerous and kind of evil and something to be very, very cautious of. But yeah, so there's five noble houses. There's Lihalan, which is they're a very pious house. They've got very close ties to the church. They are very well educated. They maintain a lot of old technology, things like that. Hazat is very much inspired by the Harkonnens from Dune. They're a very martial house. They very, very conflict oriented. Dekados are kind of the spy masters. They're very charismatic. They can use a lot of sort of underhanded tactics and stuff like that to get what they want. Hawkwood is inspired by House Atreides from Dune. They're sort of a noble house with all of that good stuff. And then Al-Malik they're the traders. They have very close ties to the trade guild, things like that. The other factions present within the game are the church. There's also the Trade Federation, Trade Consortium, I can't remember exactly what it's called. There's an alien race. Anyhow, you'll see it all as we get into it. So I'm going to play as Lihalan and go from there. I'm going to set myself on beginner. I'm going to set each of these guys on average. It just gives them a slightly tougher start. And like I said, I haven't played this in a decade, and I've never played anything with the Emperor Wars mod. So, and it changes a lot of really fundamental stuff in the game from what I've read and the little bit that I have played. So, definitely going to need a little bit of help from the AI in order for this not to turn into a disaster. The other options down here, the Plague. There's two ways you can end up with a plague breaking out on a planet. The first is if somebody drops a plague bomb, like they bombard you from orbit with a weapon that, germ warfare. And the other way is if your population starts starving. So I'm going to leave plague on, I'm going to leave rebellion on. If my troops become too disloyal, they'll rebel. Combat report just tells you what happens in combat, so that's always good to see. I'm gonna leave the tutorials on because partially for me, but partially also for you guys. Not doing play by email. Universal Warehouse means that all of my resources are shared between my planets. I don't need to actually ship from one planet to another. So if I'm producing iron on one planet and not on another one, I don't need to worry about actually shipping that iron from one to the other. Either planet can use it. And then consume food just makes your population actually eat the food that you produce. I'm going to leave that on as well. So yeah, pretty much just the default settings.
House Li Halan.
So, House Li Halan. And now what we need to do is read this, which is, in order to become emperor, you must first be elected regent. At that point, you must declare yourself emperor. If you manage to maintain that position for 10 years without everybody else killing you, the other royal houses will submit to your rule. However, should all of our nobles die, our house will become extinct. One of the things that Emperor War introduces is the ability to replace some of your nobles. It happens very, very slowly, but it's just a new unit type that they've created in the mod, so. Now we pick a picture. Sure, we'll go with him. And we'll call ourselves Imperialis. Okay. Now here, I'm also going to change some of these settings. I'm going to get rid of Friend in the Church. And I'm going to add an enemy of the church, so now I can spend two more positive traits. This part's a little bit tough for me because I'm colorblind, so the red and the greens look almost identical, but these are different traits that your house has. So right now, at least, I have Noblesse Oblige, which increases the loyalty of your subjects, makes them less likely to rebel, all that good stuff. I also have Rule of Law, which increases is a loyalty increase. These are particularly important for units, because if a unit's, like a military unit's loyalty is too low, they will run away, and if it's low enough, they will potentially rebel. Always a good thing to avoid. The other ones that I have are Ancient Documentarium, and I've got all three of those, and that gives me a little bit of starting technology. So, as far as negative traits goes, I have Disdain's Trade, which makes it more expensive for me to trade with the League. I also have an enemy in the Church, which makes the Church like me less, and an enemy in the League, which makes the League like me less. But I have these 2 points that I can spend now, and I'm going to take Noble Scholars, which increases the amount of food that I produce. And I'm also going to take Enlightened Nobility, which improves my research. So, this is kind of the setup that I remember running with most often when I used to play. So I have no idea if this is still good, or if it's not, or if it's gonna, like, having these enemies is gonna turn around and bite me terribly. But, again, haven't played this in a long time. So, now what we need to do is pick technology, what sort of technology we want to do. And one of the other things that the mod has done is revamp the tech tree. Well-strategized research is a critical aspect of success for your house in the long term. From designing more highly advanced units to creating a cure for the plague, technology will greatly help you in your quest to become emperor. From this tech screen, you can allocate your labs to research different technologies. By selecting the database button, you can strike technologies that are no longer useful, freeing up research points for more important projects. And I'll get to that in a second here, because that's an interesting mechanic within the game. And then the last here, reminder, be careful with the technologies that have been proscribed by the Church, or you may end up facing the Holy Inquisition. So the Church will actually ban different technologies. And if they catch you researching them, they'll send inquisitors to basically burn your labs to the ground, murder the, well, execute the scientists and all that sort of stuff. So, researching banned technologies can be quite dangerous. But now, this is what we are able to research. Got a whole ton of stuff, as you can see. And if we go into our database here, it shows us what we already know. So in microbiology, we know the base technology, and then we also know cellular manipulation and pharmacology. Under physics, we know gravitics. So we understand how gravity works, and we also understand how atoms work. Further down from that, in psychosociology, we understand theoretical psychosociology, or theological psychosociology, so sort of meditation and that sort of stuff, and secular psychosociology. So, and any of these you can kind of pause to look at, or pause the video and take a closer look at, but I mean, really, the tech tree is quite expansive, and to go through each individual one would take ages. The other thing we can look at here is the archive. And the archive is sort of like the Civilopedia, if you've played Civilization. Except it's interesting because it's actually written in character. And it's written by a priest. And so he's very, very vague about what, particularly what technology does. And so, for example, if I were to look at microbiology in the archive, microbiology, the study of life and what affects it, you can see he does... He talks in general what it's all about, but he doesn't give a lot of specifics, and he actually warns against a lot of the stuff that you'll find within microbiology, because the church does not like it. The church does frown upon the wanton disregard for the holiness of life shown by many of these so-called researchers. In dissecting and analyzing, they all too easily lose sight of the sacredness of life and risk their own souls in the process. So he's kind of warning you that this tech tree, this particular branch of the tech tree, is kind of dangerous. Also in here, if I go to the database, sorry, go back to that, I said I'd talk about striking technologies. Now, if the church bans something, you can strike your knowledge of it. You can literally order your scientists to burn their books and delete all their records and that sort of stuff, and strike it from your knowledge. So I could strike gravitinics there. Gravitics. If that became proscribed by the church, I could strike it from my records. And anything that I had researched further down the tree that was reliant on that, I would still have, but I would lose the knowledge of gravitics. The other thing, too, is you'll notice down here, all of the technologies have a maintenance cost. And with some of the higher... like the more advanced technologies, that maintenance cost can get quite expensive. So each turn, because I have these, it's costing me that many research points. So like these psychology ones, they're costing me 4 research points each turn. And if I strike them, then I no longer have to pay that maintenance fee. But anyhow, for now, one thing I want to get sooner rather than later excuse me, there's 2 texts that I want to pick up fairly soon. The first is material science, because that will let me start building some resource generators that I need, particularly for chemicals and electronics. And the other thing I want to get is applied technology, because that's going to get me some better armor for troops and stuff like that, and open up some of my troop options. So for now, just to open up the tech tree, I'm going to research applied technology. You'll see here it's going to cost 100 research points to get. Right now, I'm generating 104 points per turn, so it's going to take me one turn to get applied technology. And right now, I also have 94 research points currently kind of banked, I guess. It also costs money to run your labs. So if you're running low on money, you could choose to research nothing and save that money every turn. But for now, I'm going to research applied technology. Try this again. There we go. Now he's talking about how these are some of our resource generating structures. They don't have the resources they need to generate the other resources. So wetware is like cybernetic implants and stuff like that. And he also says, I've produced an extra 20 research points because of my enlightened nobility. That perk that I took at the beginning. And I receive a food bonus of 280 points because of noble scholars. Okay. So here he's just sort of explaining how to move units around. It's a fairly basic tutorial type thing. But, oh, and nobles. Having officers or nobles in a stack will give them a bonus to prevent them from retreating. And you want to be careful not to get all of your nobles killed, because if they all die, then you lose the game. And spaceships can travel planet to planet through jump gates. And some of the spaceships can transport other units. This is all just sort of the basic mechanics of how the game, like, controls and stuff, so kind of skipping through it. None of it's all that difficult. The weird things come from the user interface being somewhat dated. But anyhow, this is a planet map. So this is what the map looks like. And you'll see here, this is Holy Terra. And if you look at the map, it is indeed Earth. There's North America, Central America, South America, and right now our holdings are, looks like they're supposed to be on the Indian subcontinent, I guess in Pakistan by the looks of it. So, this is where our family's holding on Earth is. We only have the one, we just have this fort, and on here. Most of the rest of Terra is controlled by the church. Any of the red icons here are the church. We're purple. Gray is unclaimed. I mean, in this case, it's just resource tiles. But the red belongs to the church. I'll see if I can't find somebody else here. It doesn't look like it. Oh, is that our farm? Oh, yeah, it is. Okay, so we have a fort and a farm. Each of them are referred to as cities. So farm cities harvest food, always important. And officers also help. So yeah, this is also our holding here. But everything else around us here is controlled by the church. And you can see they've got some factories here, producing electronics and fusion monopropellant, I think it is. Something for spaceships. Wells produce energy. These are all the different resources down at the bottom here. And one of the interesting things about how resources work in this is they're tiered. These first four, food, energy, metal, and trace, are all produced directly from the ground. They're produced through mines, or through farms, or through wells. and they'll just straight up produce those. Oh, and exotics. So I guess the first five. So food is self-explanatory, energy self-explanatory, metal is self-explanatory. Trace basically refers to trace elements. Your mines will, any mine that is mining metal will also produce a small amount of trace. And then exotics are produced from farms, so they'll produce food and exotics, and so that'd be exotic herbs and things like that. And then up here, though, once you get past that, all of these different resources require these resources to be produced. So when it came up saying I didn't have the resources to produce wetware, which is this, if I right-click on it, blah, 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 more tutorial, it tells me what it needs to be produced. So I need a wetware factory, which obviously I must have somewhere. It requires 10 energy, 10 biochems, and 10 electronics to produce 10 wetware. So each turn, it'll gather up those resources and produce those resources. But if you look down here, you see I have 9 biochem and 9 electronics. So that's why I was not able to produce any wetware. That's why that pop-up came up. Likewise with something like chemicals, it requires 5 metal, 10 energy, 10 trace, and out of that I get 10 chemicals. So these first couple, chemicals, biochems, chemicals, electronics, chemicals and electronics only require other basic resources. So metal, energy, trace for electronics, and metal, energy, trace for chemicals. Biochems require chemicals. So I have to have someplace else producing chemicals in order to produce biochem. So it's this whole weird supply chain you have to worry about. And that's one of the big reasons why I turned Universal Warehouse on, is because otherwise I need to literally fly all of these supplies around the galaxy so I can make sure my factories stay capable of producing stuff. But anyhow, on Terra right now, there's not too much that I can do. I can take a look at the two holdings that I have here. We already looked at the farm, and then here's the fort. And in the fort, you can see we've got a... can bring up our... by right-clicking, bring up our unit list. And so we've got a Mercury freighter. So it's a small freighter. These two boxes down here represent that it can carry two units with it. We have a Serf, which is a unit that was introduced in the Emperor Wars mod, that is actually a unit that is completely non-combat. It won't fight at all. It has no attack or defense or anything like that. Well, it has armor, but that's just to protect it from orbital bombardment or something like that. But what it does is it actually gives us money each turn. So if somebody else were to come in here and conquer this fort, they would take control of the surf and they'd get the money. Noble heir. This is what I was talking about how the nobles aren't, like the rules with the nobles are a little bit different. Noble heirs are not full nobles, but after 18 turns, they turn into a nobleman. And you can create more noble heirs. They're very expensive, but it is a way to kind of keep your line going if a couple of noblemen die. But yeah, you can see they're quite expensive to create. They require 250 food, 250 metal, and 50 crystals, or 50 gems. And then this is Orthodox Priest, and like the Serf, he produces money as well. He gives me 100 gold per turn, and the Noble Heir gives me 250. I guess they're not gold, they're, what are they called? Firebirds, I think they call them. But because of his holdings, he's able to contribute to my economy, and because of his tithes, he's able to contribute to my economy. Likewise with this Sanctuary Aeon. They're another both of these are non-combat priests that just produce some resources every turn. These guys you can't build. You'll see they have no resource cost. It's just when you start with them. We'll exit out here. There's not much else to do on Terra. So now we'll go to the galaxy map. So this whole map is just a single planet of the game. And I mean, this is the size of like a Civilization 2 map, which is pretty nuts. So we'll go out to the galaxy map, and the next place we're going to take a look at is Byzantium 2. Byzantium 2 is kind of our goal for the game. This is the seat, the capital of human space. You must maintain a noble on the planet to be eligible for any office. So this is the capital. And you can see here we have a holding as well. excuse me. Now both Byzantium and Terra are neutral. There's not supposed to be any fighting on here, on either of these planets. But you'll notice we do have a garrison. We actually have a fairly strong garrison. If we look into this stack, we have three of these brother battles, who are sort of holy warriors. They're associated with the church. You also notice they don't cost any resources. That means that they cannot be built. I can't ever build more of these. You can sometimes hire them from the church and recruit them from the church, but you can't yourself build them. And then we've got another Mercury Star Freighter, another Noble Heir, another... Oh, this one is actually a combat-capable one. You see, it has a psychic attack. So it's a combat unit, but it also provides us with money. Feudal Knights. I believe that these act as officers, but I'm not 100% sure. They're another addition from the mod. But they provide us with money as well, a little bit of money. Another priest. Another priest. Another priest. The PTS Torpedo Launcher is a planetary defense weapon. Basically, if something were to try and bombard this facility from outer space, it would defend against that. Anti-air, same deal except for airplanes. Anti-tank gun batteries. So this is the anti-air and anti-tank gun batteries are very, very basic units, as well as the artillery. They're just really basic. I mean, they kind of do what they say on the tin. Indirect fire, air fire, and a little bit of direct fire capabilities. Anti-tank is designed for taking out tanks, as you might expect. They're fairly self-explanatory. But this, yeah, this is our holding on Byzantium. And one of the things I'm going to have to do here is I'm going to have to get a nobleman onto Byzantium fairly quickly. Because every 10 turns, there's a vote on who gets to become regent. We'll get to that in a minute, but if you don't have a nobleman on Byzantium, you cannot vote. You lose your vote. So it's actually a fairly key strategy in the game to sometimes kill your opponent's nobleman if you can assassinate them. And then they can't vote anymore. You can also see here, though, we've got a couple other colors here. Purple? Is this still me? This is still me. No, this isn't. Who controls this? I don't know who controls this. I have no idea who controls that. Hawkwood. So that's a holding belonging to House Hawkwood. One of the rival houses here is going to be a holding belonging to House Hazat. You can see they've got different units than us. They've got a Cyber Lord. So we've got the religious troops, they've got these cybernetic guys. And who who's here. Exit out. Oh, I can't actually look at that fort. The Agora here, the green, is an outpost of the Merchant League. And here, you can see they have troops as well, but we can also trade. And so we can buy and sell resources from them. But again, not too much exciting to do on Byzantium. So we're going to exit back out, and we're actually going to look at our home planets. And I might actually put a cut in here. I know this was literally nothing has happened in this video. We've just kind of poked around at stuff. But starting next video, we should actually get going, and yeah, we will see where this takes us. I don't know how regularly this is going to be updated or anything like that. It is still a pain to get running and recording, but yeah, we will join you next time. Please like, comment, subscribe. I'd love to hear what you think of this. If anybody's interested in a multiplayer game, message me on YouTube or leave a comment. I'd definitely be interested in taking a crack at some multiplayer in this, do a play by email or something like that. But yeah, until next time, cheers.